Visa versus MasterCard. Both are great companies, but which one offers a better value right now? In today's video, we will learn the value of both companies by using the discounted cash flow model. Hi, this is Tom from The Dividend Attitude. Looking at this image, the stock prices of both companies, it seems that Visa is the cheaper company, right? Wrong. The price that you pay is not the value of the company. So what we need to find out is what the value of both companies is. Now there are a few ways to do this. Two of them, using dividend yield theory and the dividend discount model, I have already discussed in my previous two videos. I'll put a link to those videos in the description. Today, we're going to be talking about a third way to estimate the value of a company by using the discounted cash flow model. I will guide you through it step by step and I will tell you where you can find all the information you need to put value on both companies yourself. I will reveal the winner to our valuation contest, MasterCard versus Visa, at the end of the video. And to show you I have real skin in the game of dividend stocks, I'll show you my portfolio after that. Now, this is the end result of calculating the fair value of Visa and MasterCard. As you might have noticed, I've blurred out the fair value estimate for now. You know, I don't want to spoil the surprise, of course. So if you came to this video only to get the fair value handed to you, without wanting to learn how to calculate it yourself, go ahead and skip to the end of the video to see what the fair value is. You know it is like the saying, give a man a fish and he will be fed for the day, teach a man how to fish and he will never be hungry again, or something like that. The same applies here. If you want to know the fair value of both companies and nothing else, then skip ahead. But if you really want to learn how to make these calculations yourself, then stick around and learn how to fish. Just a real quick explanation of the discounted cash flow model so you understand what we're trying to do here. A discounted cash flow model is a type of financial model that values a company by forecasting its future cash flows and discounting the cash flows to arrive at a current present value. The discounted cash flow model is widely used both in academia and in practice. Valuing companies using the discounted cash flow model is considered a core skill for investment bankers. In fact, I heard it is often a question asked at job interviews. Now we are deep diving into the actual calculation of the discounted cash flow model. So get ready. Formula for the discounted cash flow model is as follows. Don't worry, we will dissect it bit by bit. So in order to calculate that formula, we need following inputs. We need the current free cash flows of the company, and based on that we will predict future cash flows. We need the required rate of return. This is the return we as investors require in order to make a good investment. To calculate this, we will use a method called the weighted average cost of capital. In my previous video, I went over the weighted average cost of capital calculation bit by bit. So if you don't know how to calculate that, and I don't blame you, be sure to check out the video that is suggested right now in the top right corner. We also need the shares outstanding. This is the amount of common shares outstanding for Visa and MasterCard. We also need the long-term growth rate. This is the growth rate at which we expect the company to grow forever. We also need the discount factor. This is the number we are going to use to calculate future cash flows back to present cash flows. And then the company value discounted back. This is the company value we derive from all the calculated future cash flows discounted back to its present value. And lastly, the fair value. When we have all that data, we can calculate the fair value of the company. So first, we need the free cash flow. On Morningstar, this is easy to find. Go to the financials tab and then go to the free cash flow statement. At the bottom of the cash flow statement, you find what we are looking for. Free cash flow. The free cash flow is calculated by subtracting the capital expenditures, maintenance on equipment, etc., from the operating cash flow. Lucky for us, Morningstar has already done the calculation for us. So we just take those numbers and add it to our spreadsheet. In order to predict future cash flows, we need to predict the growth rate at which the free cash flow will grow. In order to calculate the future cash flows, we need to know the relation between the revenue and the net income growth, and the relation between the net income and the cash flow growth. A way to predict a revenue growth rate for the next year is to look at what analysts are predicting, though there should be a sufficient number of analysts covering the stock. We use those predictions and use historical growth rates of revenue to come up with an estimate of future cash flows. Now, the easy way is just to take an average of the historical revenue growth, but also pay attention how the average relates to the last few years, because that gives a better picture how the company is doing recently. For Visa and MasterCard, I like our averages. So again, we add those to our spreadsheet like I've done here. Now that we've predicted the revenue, we need to predict the net income. A way to do that is to calculate the historical net income margin. So this is basically the relation between revenue, the sales they make, and net income. How much profit did they make after subtracting all the costs? If you're confused about revenue and net income, I suggest you to watch my video on how to analyze an income statement first. Again, look at how the average net income margin compares to the last few years. We go ahead and add those numbers to the spreadsheet as well. But we're not there yet. To predict future future cash flow is based on revenue, we need to know the relation between revenue and cash flow. How much free cash flow are they producing when producing a certain amount of net income? As before, look at how the average compares to the recent years. So we add those numbers to our spreadsheet as well. There are two ways to come up with the required rate of return. You can make an estimate based on your own requirements, risk profile, etc. Or you can use a method that is called the weighted average cost of capital, or WACC for short. The latter is based on what the company itself would require as a rate of return for their own internal investments. That is a method we can use as investors as well. Again, I've made an extensive explanation how to come up with the weighted average cost of capital in a video you see suggested at the top. I think the weighted average cost of capital calculation represents a truer representation of the required rate of return since it is specific to the company. To keep this video on topic, I will not explain in this video exactly how I come up with the weighted average cost of capital for Visa and MasterCard. Instead, I will show you the input I used for both Visa and MasterCard to calculate my weighted average cost of capital. If you want to double check this, I've put a link to the Google Sheet I've used for this calculation in the description. One thing I've changed since the last video is the estimated return of the market I use for my weighted average cost of capital calculation. In the previous video, I used 10% as a long-term market return. However, after considering that since 1957, when the current form of the S&P 500 with 500 companies was introduced, return was 8%. I think that is a better representation. For the number of shares outstanding, there's actually a cool thing you can do to get the number of outstanding common shares for a company, because you can pull the number of outstanding shares straight from Google Finance with the following formula. Be sure to chop off the last three digits, because the previous numbers are in thousands as well. The number of outstanding shares can also be found in each annual and quarterly report, so be sure to cross-check it with the number in the actual annual report. The perpetual growth rate is the constant growth rate of free cash flow indefinitely. For this number, we will use a conservative number of 2.5%. That is midpoint of the historical inflation rate of 2-3%. The historical GDP growth rate is 4-5%. The idea is behind taking the number that inflation and GDP growth rate as a benchmark is that we can't expect the company to be growing at a faster pace than the total economy itself. That would be at some point, remember, this is forever growth rates, that Visa would be bigger than the economy itself, which of course is not possible. The terminal value is basically the value at the beginning of period 5. The way to calculate this is free cash flow at the end of period 4 times 1 plus the growth rate divided by the required rate of return minus the growth rate. So like the formula you see on the screen. The discount factor is the factor which you are going to discount the future free cash flow with to calculate it back to a present free cash flow derived from the future cash flow. For this, we are going to take our required rate of return plus 1 and we raise that by the factor of 1 for each year into the future. So for 2020, that is 1 plus 7.4% to the factor of 1, and 2021, that is 1 plus 7.4% to the factor of 2, etc. The company value discounted back is the sum of the free cash flows plus the terminal value. This is the basis to come up with the fair value estimate. So like you can see here with formula on the screen. So who will be the winner of this valuation contest? Visa or MasterCard? To come up with fair value, we will divide the number of outstanding shares by the discounted company value. In using the discounted cash flow model, Visa has a fair value of $152. A MasterCard a fair value of $125. Looking at the current stock price, they are both overvalued, but who offers the better value right now? And the winner is Visa. The share price is closer to the fair value right now, so they offer better fair value than MasterCard. So who would you pick? Let me know in the comments below. So when can we use the discounted cash flow model? We can use the discounted cash flow model if it meets any of these four criteria. So one, company has somewhat predictable cash flow growth rate, or free cash flow aligns with net income, or company does not pay a dividend, or a company pays a dividend but this does not impair their ability to grow. So again, look at the payout ratio. Keep in mind that like any model, this model is based on assumptions. So the quality of your fair value estimate is dependent on the quality of your assumptions. That is why I use a very modest long-term growth rate and I use the weighted average cost of capital calculation to come up with my required rate of return. Like I mentioned in about every video, my portfolio consists of mainly dividend growth companies, with the exception of CVS. The total portfolio value in Bing now stands at €7,124. In 2020 so far, the unrealized loss is 16.73% and €1,380. So compared to last week, there's a difference of about 3.5%. As dividend growth investors, we are focused on our dividends growing, and that is still happening. So far, no dividend cuts in my portfolio. Compared to the S&P 500 mini future, since the start of this portfolio, there's still about a 2.5% difference, as you can see here. And I will do a more extensive update on the incoming dividends at the end of May. Inegira 3M is now a little bit above break-even, but that has more to do with fluctuations in the currency exchange rate. And SKT is still down significantly, but as you can see, the dividends are coming in. And there's some perspective since more stores are opening again. And as usual, both portfolios combined in Google Sheets. The total amount of dividends still stands at $726. As I said, I will update that at the end of the month. Total value stands at $8,217, which is a negative 1.46% change and a $121 negative change compared to the cost. And that's excluding dividends. Including dividends, the change is positive 7.24% and $604 change compared to the cost. If you want to learn more on how to analyze a company, be sure to check out my How to Research Dividend Stocks playlist, of which I will put a link in the description and you can click on it right here in the top right corner. I suggest you to watch my video on the dividend discount model next, which you can click on here in the bottom right corner. As always, if you like this video, please hit that like button and subscribe to get updated on future videos. Next up is a video on how to value a company based on price to earning. So if you want to get a notification straight when that video comes out, subscribe and turn your notifications on by hitting the little bell next to it. Until next time, bye bye.